Thank you very much for that very generous introduction. Your cheque is in the post. One of the things that structured the workshop today, and one of the things I want to reflect on now really, is women all over the world are marching in opposition to Trump, but in opposition to, I think, huge swings at the right, a huge, extraordinarily depressing series of developments in many countries. I was thinking about in Poland almost banning women's access to abortion. And reading with these wonderfully talented poets, and indeed being on the shortlist with other fantastic, this is a great time for women, women poets, but it's great poetry. This is a fantastic, doing new things with it. I was born into a family with six sisters, so I'm kind of like used to being surrounded by talented women. And sometimes I get asked to write poems for weddings, and the fact that I grew up with six sisters, all of whom were married at least once, did influence the sonnet that indeed I ended up writing. Bridal vows. I will be faithful to you, I do vow, but not until the seas have all run dry, etc. Although I mean it now, I'm not a prophet, and I will not lie. To be your perfect wife, I could not swear. I'll love, yes, honour, maybe, won't obey, but will cooperate if you will care as much as you are seeming to today. I'll do my best to be your better half, but I don't have the patience of a saint, and at you, not with you, I sometimes laugh and snap too, though I try to learn restraint. We might work out. No blame if we do not. With all my heart, I think it's worth a shot. That was a kind of very obvious sonnet. This is really, half the story is really two prose pieces, although they are 14 lines each, that kind of allude to the idea of the sonnet. And I have been working with refugees. The refugee in this half the story is Kafka's great love, Dora. Dora ended up a refugee in London, a refugee from Stalin and Hitler, died in London. If you go to her grave, as I did, on the gravestone it says, "Who knows Dora knows what love means." And you can read that in many ways. I take one of the stories that she mentioned, trace what happened to it in other versions of it, and it ended up as a sort of parable about narratives, really. Franz Kafka, the story goes, encountered a little girl in the park where he walked regularly. She was crying. She lost her doll. Kafka helped the girl search for the doll, but they couldn't find it. They arranged to meet there the next day to look again for her doll, but still they could not find it. When they met for the third time, Kafka gave her a tiny letter that he told her he found nearby. She read, "Don't be sad, I'm only travelling. I'll write, I promise." And every day that summer, when Kafka and the little girl met, he'd read a new letter to her describing places the doll had visited, who it met there and what it did. The little girl was comforted. When the holiday was over and she had to go back to school, he gave her a doll that he said was the lost prodigal returned. And if it seemed a little different from the doll of her memory, a note pinned to its scarf explained, "My travels changed me." Or so ends this version of the story, popular with therapists. But in Dora Diamond's own account, our one first-hand source, there was no new doll, no message of change or growth. Instead, Dora had described a final letter sent to the little girl, detailing how the doll had met its soulmate and had married him, how she would be too busy with the new family to write again, enjoining the little girl to seek similar fulfillment in her own life. Dora also noted how this affair had driven Kafka to distraction, who'd endured quiet nights, tortured by his own compassion, feverishly thinking up new adventures for his changeling doll made out of letters and lies and love. How this correspondence had been maintained in this fashion for a period of 3 weeks, as long as that holiday when Dora Dynitz had first met France, a place with a name I only half recall now, Ra something. Ra Gurwitz, of course, there is a braille theme in the book. All of these are from the Blind Road Maker. The Grail question, of course, is very important. And the Grail question that Parsifal fails to ask. This is the Blue Queen of Astroland, and has an epigraph from one of the young people that's about. Astroland comes from a book that was written by Lee's author called Bernard Hare, about a group of young people who dropped out of school, don't work, and hoisting is shoplifting. That's how they make their money. Hence all the details of the clothes that they wear. They did actually make a film with this, but they couldn't find a distributor. Ashtrayland means England. England is this remote place, burned out country, irrelevant to them, its history, and all of that, of absolutely no consequence to them. But the question, it quotes Molly as an epigraph, but also there's a verse from one of the young people called Skeeter, the man who wrote about the primary one. But Holly's question is, what the fuck is the Holy Grail? The hair glows burnished as the gold that trims a Nike cardigan. Iron and white to feel our trainers, DKNY jeans and cap. Her skin's as blue as old skimmed milk, as blue the star on her left cheek. A boastful beauty spot tattooed with broken glass and laundry ink. The dam is dammed, the brown old tooted. A homegrown hydroponic skunk or shotgun blown back jointed bond. The queen calls for her royal swan. Through snakebite piercings on her lips, the bitten red adapter hissed like Cleopatra's asp its gas. Our queen jerks upright, claps her hands, with no round table lay hand round white lightning in 2 litre flasks. She necks a draught and kicks a minstrel. Skeeter fills the block with song. Bring me my dig of burning gold. Bring me Viagra of desire. Bring me my foil, O clouds unfold. Bring me my milligrams of fire. A knight's take after Robert Dealer. Urban's passed out on his crate. Peeling back a cardboard curtain, the queen looks down on her estate. I've been working with refugees in different capacities. This is about a person who came to Leeds, Manuel Bravo. The Kafkaesque world of refugees, when they don't know the decisions that are going to affect them so completely, how they're taken, when they will be taken. Manuel Bravo didn't have legal representation at his case, and he didn't understand that he'd lost. The first he knew of the fact that he was going to be deported was when they came to take him away. There is now an agency named after Manuel Bravo, dedicated to helping people have a proper legal representation. This is the story of Manuel Bravo and what he did. He was a Christian. A lot of it is from the Book of Job. He was very active with the local Church of England. Sometimes refugees, the person I was talking to yesterday was quite clearly Muslim. I asked him about his name, Rashid. I said it means divine, divinely guided one. Isn't it one of the 99 names of Allah? And as soon as I mentioned that, I just thought it was terrible that now he's embarrassed to admit to being a Muslim. He thinks he will get a hostile response. Sometimes people would convert to Christianity for strategic reasons, but I think Manuel was a Christian in Angola, where he came from. The full weight of the law. Let me be weighed in an even balance, but I was not. The scales fell from my eyes while justice stayed blind. Her scale pennies lifted from a dead man's eyes. My lawyer didn't show, and I was mute at my tribunal. When I came to this land, as I learned its languages, its poetry, Shakespeare, King James's Bible, its weather. By the breath of God, frost is given. He saith to the snow, be thou on the earth, likewise to the small rain. In time, I even got to like it. Hast thou entered into the treasures of the snow, or hast thou seen the treasures of the hail? Hail like uncut diamonds from my home, blood diamonds. More than it's silent, I like rain merciful that droppeth slow. I found out I had lost, but that my son Antonio could stay if I should die. So my immortal soul was a small forfeit, as light as that feather of truth on those scales of Anubis we saw at the papyrus scroll on our visit to the Leeds Museum. God stretcheth out the north over the empty place and hangeth the earth upon nothing. With its twisted sheets, I weigh myself in Yao's wood detention center stairwell. My soul chooseth strangling and death rather than life. The blind road major has many meanings, but also only one level. The overarching blind road major in the book is love. Love is blind. I remember looking up how many times love will find a way on the internet. It appears in dozens of songs. But literally, I was astonished to discover that the person who made the road I take into Leeds and out again in the opposite direction was blind from the age of six, Jack Metcalfe, a major road builder in the north of England. Extraordinary that he should be forgotten. My son was volunteering in a blind school at the time. Nobody knew anything about him. Most astonishing character. It's like my opposite, really. You know, he was dynamic in so many areas, you know, and I'm just stumbling along in the light, really. That kind of is in this guy, in this shadow. It's called In His Shadow. As an epigraph from a wonderful poet, Canadian poet, Anne Carson, I would say that knowing is a road. Colourful blackjack would see right through me, colourless, beside his many coats and trades. Technicolor escapades my dull ink must betray. A froggy lover, like those he saw off at Culloden, he'd scorn me stumbling, comme sur le pavé. How I use that line from Baudelaire for a crutch. My fiddle with words, while his own played tunes, Jack only had to hear once to know backwards. He played to lead the Yorkshire Blues into battle. Women fell for him too. Even later on in his life, when Jack always stunk of pitch like old Nick, he could sweet talk or write to get somewhere. Testing stones to bed his road's black tongues, I heard how Jack rolled them around in his mouth like new words. What I would know about that. A sequence in the book revolves a project I did around Shandy Hall. Tristram Shandy, one of my favourite books, and at the heart of it is the relationship between Toby and the widow Wadman. And the widow Wadman knows that Toby was injured in his upper thigh in battle, and she doesn't know what that means. Is it a euphemism? So she's interested in marrying him, but can he do the business, you know? And at one point he says to her, would you like to see where I was injured, you know? She sort of thinks about it for a while, gives me interest in chatting about three chapters. And she sort of thinks, well, he knows I'm a widow, I've been around the block a few times. She says, yes sir, I would like to see you injured. So he gets out his maps, he says, the seeds of Namor are attacking him. But this is the white page. She's so beautiful, the widow Wadman is so beautiful, he says, that however I describe her, it will be a disappointment to you. So I will leave this black page, and that's the white page. As an epigraph from Jean Cocteau, poets don't draw, they unravel their handwriting and then tie it up again, a different letter. If you stretch out this writing into one long, thin, single line, draw it to an invisible thread, you can make its information your own material, giving you the whip hand over this verse, this universe, Then, with the flick of your wrist, it will wriggle into a silhouette of your own fancy. A portrait of Widow Rodman, left blank in Tristram Shandy by Stern for your realisation in Seek Sue's ink. Or like letters, Molly Blue sends herself with love's blind signature. I was in the local co-op a while ago and remarked on the strange weather to a woman who worked there. And she said, Mother Shipton said we would know no seasons. I just thought that was fantastic. You know? I didn't really want to do the whole oral history thing and grill her. It was wonderful that Mother Shipton is still saturating the local language, you know. And the language of Mother Shipton is really what this is about. It's not about the prophecies. It's not about the extraordinary variety of ways that she is represented. If you look at old pictures of her, she actually has Punch's face. Punch takes over her face in the course of the centuries, you know. But anyway, this is Mother Shipton. I know you'll pass the world's end bar to cross that river by the well, whose water changes time to stone, to find thy ultra sibyl's home. You'll know her face as sickle moon from moth's wings, punch, odd bills for glaze, and meet the words of meeting fate from peeps, defoe, the internet. In her unending, ending worlds, hairs make our hearts their birthing beds. A thorn hangs horses, swords plough fields, while one-eyed women wade through blood. What all this means, the wise don't ask, but watch from shadows in her cave. Dead metaphors escape their grave to breathe again behind her mask. And I'm going to finish with a poem called Combat Gnosticism. My father was in the Irish Army, born in Tipperary, where Stern was born. His father was in the English Army. Combat Gnosticism is a phrase which we explained in the poem. Campbell's term, combat Gnosticism. Campbell's term for war writing born of a gnosis only being there can earn. I witnessed it once from old soldiers in a poetry workshop at age concerned. They'd lost that battle with the word, believing too much best left unsaid to the likes of me and not those pals, now 70 dead. How many old soldiers does it take to change a light bulb? Asked one. You can't know if you weren't there. They fell about. Now they won. Relaxed, they began letting it out into grey shades of afternoon light. Into the words they feared betrayed it. And I learned why they were right. Thank you for listening to me.